start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes, they are longing to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. I wanna wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap.
My small town blues, they are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it.
Final chapter of Rem Koolhaas' retroactive manifesto, Delirious New York, opens up with an explanation of the paranoid critical method of the surrealist painter Salvador Dali. PCM is an obsession with organizing the material supporting a single motif to the point of what Koolhaas describes as delirious associations of interpretations. If a person lives inside this paranoia for an extended period of time, this results in an intense and distorted relationship with reality. In the 1930s, Le Corbusier begins a 15-year attempt to create the new city. In the final chapter of Delirious New York, Koolhaas states the French architect develops the horizontal skyscraper as the radiant city as an attempt to destroy New York's credibility and kill the glamorous sparkle of its modernity. Fortunately for New York City, he is merely guilty of paranoid critical thinking, obsessing over problems of congestion and lobotomy, designing in a distorted reality, blind to their function as the lifeblood of New York City. Manhattan rejects his large-scale imposition and remains an archipelago of paranoid critical islands, insulated by the lagoon of the grid. Before Le Corbusier had stepped in foot in New York City to propose its potential apocalypse, a group of architects, city planners, engineers were already building the Ark to imaginary flood. Rockefeller Center is the ultimate product of smooth congestion, simultaneously programmed and interior-exterior separation. With the Rockefeller Center as a precedent, each block of Manhattan had the potential to harbor such an Ark.
Rockefeller Center, conceived in the same spirit of aesthetic devotion, is designed to satisfy in pattern and service the many-sided spirit of our civilization. By solving its own varied problems, by bringing beauty and business into closer companionship, it promises a significant contribution to the city planning of an untold future.
The perfect example is Radio City Music Hall. After the theater's erection on the site, the stale vaudeville show is unfit for the vibrant needs of popular culture. Shortly thereafter, the Rockettes are imagined as the new culture tradition is held up by the colorful, flashy architecture of the space.
Entertainment Center marks a new era for the theater. Great first night attracted a list of celebrities. And now let's hear from a few.
The most magnificent thing I've ever seen in all my life.
David Sarnoff, RCA, one of the men whose vision made the music hall possible. Gene Tunney, former boxing champion.
Judge Ed Rossi on this marvelous turnout tonight.
Oh, what a marvelous theater. You should be here too.
Exactly. Radio City and everyone connected with the enterprise. Magnificent accomplishment.
Hello, folks. Is everybody happy?
Thank you.
Emerging from an elevator on the ninth floor, the visitor finds himself in a dark vestibule that leads directly into a locker room that occupies the center of the platform where there is no daylight. There, he undresses, puts on his boxing gloves, and enters an adjoining space equipped with a multitude of punching bags. On the southern side, the same locker room is also serviced by an oyster bar with a view over the Hudson River.
Prior to the perfect design of Rockefeller Center, in 1931, the Downtown Athletic Club was built near the Hudson River. In the 38-story skyscraper, while the exterior remains constant, each interior floor is a programmatic performance of the metropolitan instability. As a member rides on the 13 elevators up, each stop provides a unique and intense experience of social activity, such as the iconic eating oysters with boxing gloves, naked on the ninth floor. In this way, program, a simple interest in what happens, is redefined based on the congestion functionalism. Rem Koolhaas explores the section of the Downtown Athletic Club again in the second proposal for Paris's Parc de la Villette. Essentially, Koolhaas turns this section on its side to create a plan for the park. The park still explores the programmatic instability of the club, only this time without the issue of containment. With this, he's able to create density without architecture, a culture of invisible congestion. As New York City experiences a scale explosion, skyscrapers appear at a growing rate. The 1916 zoning law develops to protect the street's natural light from the towering structures. During this period of time, several Manhattan theories are realized. First, Hugh Ferris studies the abilities of each block of the city grid to operate with individual program and infrastructure. This creates a drastic assertion of the most primitive model of human cohabitation, a mega village. At the time, Harvey Corbett imagines New York City as a modernized Venice, where pedestrians use raised bridges to pass over canals of automobiles. Ferris Mega's village and Corbett's modernized Venice share a common ground. Both theories are generated by congestion. In order to progress, New York's problem must be seen as a positive in order to thrust Manhattan into a perpetual flight forward. The culture of congestion generates demands, which will be reproduced naturally and artificially through the technology of the fantastic. The final result will be 2,028 mega-villages islands in a modernized Venice.
The culture of congestion proposes the conquest of each block by a single structure. On each floor, the culture of congestion will arrange new and exhilarating human activities in unprecedented combinations. Each city within a city will be so unique that it will naturally attract its own inhabitants.
This interest in congestion began for Rem Koolhaas during his thesis project for the AA. The project, Exodus of Voluntary Prisoners of Architecture, which walled off a new city within London, explored an urban culture formed by its architecture and congestion created by choice. Before an unstable combination of simultaneous activities can penetrate the floors of the skyscraper, the infrastructure is built. Each block of grid extrudes skyward using an escalating form of automatic steel construction in order to turn its self-contained enclave of the irresistible synthetic. Rem Koolhaas provides a theory for the infrastructural success of the skyscraper, the Great Lobotomy. The tradition in Western architecture, up until the birth of the skyscraper, was an honest facade that reflected the program behind it. However, with the skyscraper, New York architects embraced the architectural lobotomy, severing the facade from the program and therefore sparing the outside world from the agonies of the continuous changes raging inside it. The Great Lobotomy satisfies two conditions, the need for a monolithic experience from the street and the need for program flexibility inside.
The genius of Manhattan is the simplicity of this divorce between appearance and performance. It keeps the illusion of architecture intact while surrounding wholeheartedly to the needs of the metropolis.
In 1883, the completion of the Brooklyn Bridge opens the floodgate to New York's Coney Island. The island is a laboratory for the urban development of the growing Manhattan. The island's beach serves as an escape from reality for the busy city dwellers, but as the popularity of the beach drastically increases, changing facilities, food, accommodations, and entertainment are built to satisfy the pleasure of the feverish congestion. Mid-1890s, George Tillieu assembles a racetrack at his new Steeplechase Park. Mechanical horses offer a purely synthetic exhilaration of horseback riding. Frederick Thompson constructs Luna Park, an amusement park with more thematic and architectural coherence. Here, the skyline of randomized towers lit up at night with thousands of electric lights offers an alternative to the dreary reality of the city. Lastly, politician William Reynolds designs Dreamland. Here, 17 fantastical programs are arranged without order, sending the attendee on a nonsensical stream of consciousness.
In less than a decade, they have invented and established an urbanism based on the new technology of the fantastic, a permanent conspiracy against the realities of the external world. It defines completely new relationships between site, program, form, and technology. The site has now become a miniature state, the program its ideology, and architecture the arrangement of the technological apparatus that compensates for the loss of real physicality.
Manhattan is discovered by Henry Hudson and the East India Company in 1609, and by 1623, a Dutch colony is established. New Amsterdam is originally a collection of four houses amidst Indian villages and settlements, but soon develops into a pentagonal fort. Attempts to establish an urban plan of some kind were made, but order was not established until long after the colony's dissolution. It was not until 1807 that Manhattan's grid was established. 2,028 blocks were created through an implementation of 12 avenues and 155 streets.
The plotting of its streets and blocks announces that the subjugation, if not obliteration, of nature is its true ambition.
The most notable exception to the single block domination is Central Park, but even this piece of nature within the man-made landscape of Manhattan is an act of subjugating nature. The park is described as a synthetic Arcadian carpet grafted onto the grid and is dominated by artificial lakes, planted trees, and engineered accidents.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes, they are longing to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. I want to wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. My small town blues, they are melting away.
I want to play this for you different than you ever heard.